The Queen's Gambit is a Netflix limited series, so here's a question. Does a limited series mean just one season? When I heard about this series, I didn't pay much attention to the trailer. I didn't research or look it up at all, not because I wasn't interested, I was just busy with other reviews, but mostly because I just assumed what it was already. My girlfriend put it on later and I sat down to watch the very least one episode. Then I found myself watching another and another, well into the fourth episode. My initial thought of this series was a Russian spy thriller set in the Cold War about a girl who played chess, possibly taking down a Russian dictator. It beats me why I assume that. I'm not one to judge a book by its cover, but there are so many Russian spy films. I guess when I heard a little bit about this series, that's what came to mind. But I was wrong, and I'm glad. It turns out it's a character drama about an American orphan girl who is taught chess by a custodian in her orphanage. She is quickly discovered by a community of chess players at the age of 9. I'll admit, at first glance, I was watching this show, everything was interesting but the chess. Growing up, I've watched a few games of chess for just a moment, and I found myself bored, just kind of like golf. After watching The Queen's Gambit, I can sort of see now how competitive and tactical chess can be. In no means will that motivate me to start learning the game, but maybe if I come across a game, I might pay a little bit more attention to it. The tone in the first three episodes is a bit more dramatic than the rest of the series. We get a glimpse of how Elizabeth Harmon, played by Elsa Johnston, is orphaned. Her performance, although limited to two episodes, was very strong, very believable, as a young girl who lost a parent. She becomes quiet and standoffish at first with her new home, but she doesn't care about the rules of the place. She tests her boundaries, and that's how she discovers chess. There are several scenes throughout the first two episodes of 9-year-old Harmon using drugs that are given to her to calm her nerves. She hides them and uses them at night to visualize her chess moves on her ceiling above her bed. It makes for an eerie scene. You'd think it comes from a thriller or a horror genre. It then skips to her age at 17, and she is adopted by a woman with a lonely marriage. When she arrives at this new home, it becomes a play out of fish out of water scenario for a bit, but Anya Taylor-Joy's Harmon quickly dives into a social circle of chess players. The transformation between Elsa and Anya's Harmon characters are seamless. It was molded well. Both characters play out the same traits and personalities, a couple being standoffish and very stubborn. And of course, if she wants something, she goes and she gets it, no matter what it takes. She doesn't let her dramatic and insecurity experiences hold her back, and I think that's a good lesson here to learn when brought out the right way. Never sit back and tell yourself you're scared or you'll do it later when you feel more confident. Throughout the series, Harmon meets several men who are expert players. She begins relationships with. They are short-lived due to their more powerful love for the game of chess. There is a scene in which Harmon's guardian is surprised at how much chess pays in championships. And so she asks for a percentage right there. I was thinking, here it is, the expected moment when an apparent loved one uses the protagonist for their own game. But then she does ask for only a small percentage, and Harmon agrees to give her 5% more instead. Another moment in the show I found sweet was when a reporter asked Harmon who taught her chess. Harmon says the custodian at her orphanage and tells the reporter to make sure he puts that in the article. In an average film or series, you'd most likely find the protagonist in their time of success and wealth become selfish in their answers, saying things like, I taught myself, or they acknowledge someone benefiting from their success that had nothing to do with the upbringing of the sport or game. Things then take a dramatic turn, and Harm is left to fend for herself. She manages in one way, but she quickly picks up someone else's habits. It's like this for about two episodes, where she goes through a phase of feeling sorry for herself. Those two episodes I didn't care much for. Of course, it was good to see a vulnerable side of her, but this particular way was done in plenty of movies and shows, so it ain't nothing new. They could have found a way to mash both episodes together, or at least make them a little bit more unique. But they do close this part of the series with a heartfelt moment in her past at the orphanage. She confronts something that really changed her life, and from there, she starts her resurgence, and the series picks up again. The last episode gets pretty intense. Harmon is invited to Russia to play against a grandmaster. There are moments in the episode where you have the whole nation involved in the tournament. The public stands outside the building. Others are hearing the results from each play through a radio. It's that big moment when the world thinks it'll change their lives. As the series comes to a close, I for some reason was expecting a subplot in which Harmon would be recruited to be an infiltrator for a season two. But the series nicely ends with no trace of a follow-up season. And that's why I was wondering about whether a limited series is a mandatory one season, or is it as long as the story takes to get to an inevitable ending. Minus some of the flaws, I did like the series. I especially liked the first three episodes, and jumping to the last, somewhere in between, it was all right. It could have been more tightened up. I'll recommend The Queen's Gambit. Thanks for watching. You agree or disagree? Put a comment down below me.